It is the solution of IIT JEE Mains 2015 for chemistry. The question number one is from solution, and the subtopic is colligated properties and the relative lowering of vapor pressure. The question says, the vapor pressure of acetone at 20 degrees Celsius is 185 torr. When 1.2 grams of a non-volatile substance was dissolved in 100 grams of acetone at 20 degrees Celsius, its vapor pressure was 183 torr. The molar mass in grams per mole of the substance is, and the options are 488, 32, 64, 128. The formula used here is Gaia solute is equal to delta P divided by P naught solvent, where Gaia solute is the mole fraction of the solute, delta P is the decrease in the vapor pressure of the solvent on adding the solute, and P naught solvent is the original vapor pressure of the solvent. The original vapor pressure of acetone at 20 degrees Celsius is given as 185 torr. The vapor pressure after addition of solute is 183 torr. So, the decrease in vapor pressure, delta P, is 2 torr. Using the formula, Gaia solute is equal to delta P divided by P naught solvent, we get the mole fraction of the solute as 2 divided by 185. Considering a dilute solution in which the moles of solute can be neglected in comparison to the solvent, the mole fraction of the solute, that is Gaia solute, is equal to moles of solute divided by moles of the solvent. Now, this is equal to mass of the solute divided by the molar mass of the solute, which will give us the moles of the solute, while the mass of the solvent divided by molar mass of the solvent will give us the moles of the solvent. So, the mole fraction of the solute turns out to be mass of the solute divided by molar mass of the solute. This entirely divided by mass of the solvent divided by molar mass of the solvent. The solvent is acetone, CH3COCH3, with molar mass 58 grams per mole. The mass of the acetone given is 100 grams and of solute is 1.2 grams. Substituting in the formula, the equation becomes mole fraction of the solute is equal to moles of the solute divided by moles of the solvent, which is equal to the mass of the solute divided by molar mass of the solute, and whole divided by mass of the solvent divided by molar mass of the solvent, which is equal to 1.2 divided by molar mass of the solute, whole divided by 100 divided by 58. Equating it with the mole fraction of the solute obtained by the previous equation, we get mole fraction of the solute is equal to 2 by 185, which in turn is equal to 1.2 divided by molar mass of the solute divided by 100 by 58. Now, the molar mass of the solute turns out to be equal to 1.2 multiplied by 58 into 185 divided by 100 multiplied by 2. This comes out to be 64.38, which can be approximately taken as 64 grams per mole. Second question is from the chapter Surface Chemistry and the subtopic Adsorption. The question says, 3 grams of activated charcoal was added to 50 milliliter of acetic acid solution, which is 0.06 normal, in a flask. After an hour, it was filtered and the strength of the filtrate was found to be 0.042 normal. The amount of acetic acid adsorbed per gram of charcoal is, the options are 54 milligram, 18 milligram, 36 milligram and 42 milligram. Now, activated charcoal is prepared by heating the normal charcoal to a higher temperature. This removes the various gas molecules sticking on its surface and makes the surface free to take up any other substance. When activated charcoal is put in a solution of acetic acid, the charcoal adsorbs the acetic acid and the concentration of acetic acid in the solution decreases. Here, the acetic acid is the adsorbate and charcoal is the adsorbent. The adsorption is mentioned as the mass of adsorbate per unit mass of adsorbent. The mass of adsorbate is represented as X, and the mass of adsorbent or the moles of adsorbent is represented as M. The initial concentration of acetic acid which is given is 0.06 normal. The final concentration of acetic acid after adsorption has taken place is 0.042 normal. The change in concentration of acetic acid is 0.06 minus 0.042, and that turns out to be 0.018 normal. The total volume of the solution given is 50 milliliter. The total change in millimoles or milliequivalents is equal to the change in normality multiplied by the volume in milliliters. That is equal to 0.018 multiplied by 50. We need to understand here is that acetic acid is a monobasic acid. It has one replaceable hydrogen. Hence, its equivalent is equal to its mole. The total change in mass in milligram is equal to the change in millimoles into molar mass. That is equal to 0.018 into 50 into 60 milligrams, where 60 is the molar mass of acetic acid. The mass of charcoal given is 3 grams. So mass of acetic acid adsorbed per gram of activated charcoal will turn out to be 0.018 divided by 3, multiplied by 50, multiplied by 60, that is 18 milligrams. The next question is from atomic structure, the subtopic Bohr theory, and that is hydrogen spectra. Question says, which of the following is the energy of a possible excited state of hydrogen? And the options are plus 6.8 electron volts, plus 13.6 electron volts, or minus 6.8 electron volts, or minus 3.4 electron volts. This question demands the answer to be chosen from the options. The question typically has infinite answers, so we have to find the answers till one of them matches the options given. Energy of the electron in any shell of hydrogen is given by the expression En is equal to E naught by n square, where E naught is the energy of the electron in the first shell of hydrogen. The value is minus 13.6 electron volts per atom. The first excited state would be the second energy state, that is n equal to 2, while the second excited state would be the third energy state, that is n equal to 3, and so on. The energy of the first excited state would be En is equal to minus 13.6 divided by 2 square. Now this turns out to be minus 3.4 electron volts. This is an option in the question, so this is the answer. The next question is from P block elements, and that too from group 17 halogens, and out of that of interhalogen compounds. Question says, which among the following is the most reactive? And the options are ICl, that is iodine chloride, Cl2, Br2, or I2. An interhalogen compound is a molecule which contains two or more different halogen atoms, that is fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine, or astatine, and no atoms of elements from any other group. Typically, interhalogen bonds are more reactive than diatomic halogen bonds because interhalogen bonds are weaker than diatomic halogen bonds. Except for F2, interhalogen compounds like ICl have a charge separation and a polarity. Hence, it is easier for the species with charge separation such as water to react with them. So, the most reactive amongst these species is ICl, that is iodine chloride. The next question is from polymers. The question says, Which polymer is used in the manufacture of paints and lacquers? Options are polyvinyl chloride, bakelite, glyptal, or polypropene. Polyvinyl chloride, PVC, is a widely used plastic containing carbon, hydrogen, and chlorine. It is produced by the process of polymerization. Molecules of vinyl chloride monomers combine to make long chain molecules of polyvinyl chloride. This synthetic polymer is relatively cheap and easy to mold. Bakelite or polyoxybenzyl methylene glycol anhydride is an early plastic. It's a thermosetting phenol formaldehyde resin formed from a condensation reaction of phenol with formaldehyde. One of the first plastics made from synthetic components, bakelite was used for its electrical non-conductivity and heat-resistant properties in electrical insulators, radio and telephone casings, and such diverse products as kitchenware, jewelry, pipe stems, children toys, and firearms. Although glyptal was originally developed as an insulating paint for electrical application such as treatment of coils and armatures, its outstanding resistance to corrosion, moisture, oil, acid, heat, dust, and salt sprays has made it popular throughout industry as a primer, sealer, adhesive, and protective finish. Polypropylene, PP, also known as polypropene, is a thermoplastic polymer used in a wide variety of applications including packaging and labeling, textiles, example ropes, thermal underwear and carpets, stationery, plastic parts and reusable containers of various types, laboratory equipments, loudspeakers, automotive components and polymer banknotes. An addition polymer made from the monomer propylene, it is rugged and unusually resistant to many chemical solvents, bases and acids. The next question is from basic concepts of chemistry, that is stoichiometry and mole concept. The question says, the molecular formula of a commercial resin used for exchanging ions in water softening is C8H7SO3Na. Molar mass 206. What would be the maximum uptake of calcium ions by the resin when expressed in mole per gram resin? The first option, 1 by 412, second, 1 by 103, third, 1 by 206, and fourth, 2 by 309. This is a typical stoichiometry question. Sodium has the valency of 1, while calcium has the valency of 2. Hence, the amount of resin required for calcium will be double of what is required by sodium. Molar mass of sodium resin is 206 grams. 2 mole of the resin will be obtained by 2 moles of the sodium salt, that is 2 into 206 grams. 412 grams of sodium resin will take up 1 mole of calcium. 1 gram of sodium resin will take up 1 by 412 mole of calcium. The next question is from organic chemistry. Some basic principles and techniques having Carius method. The question says, in Carius method of estimation of halogens, 250 milligrams of an organic compound gave 141 milligrams of AgBr. The percentage of bromine in the compound is atomic mass of silver 108, atomic mass of bromine 80, and the options are 60, 24, 36, and 48. The Carius halogen method in analytical chemistry is a method for the quantitative determination of halogens in chemical substances. A known mass of an organic compound is heated with fuming nitric acid in the presence of silver nitrate contained in a hard glass tube known as the Carius tube in a furnace. Carbon and hydrogen present in the compound are oxidized to carbon dioxide and water. The halogen present forms the corresponding silver halide, that is AgX. It is filtered, washed, dried, and weight. The atomic mass of bromine is 80. Atomic mass of silver is 108. In Carrier's method, 80 grams of bromine will give 188 grams of silver bromide precipitate. 188 grams of silver bromide is given by 80 grams of bromine. 141 milligrams of silver bromide is given by 80 divided by 188 multiplied by 141 milligrams of bromine. Total mass of the organic compound given to us is 250 milligrams. 250 milligrams of organic compound contains 80 divided by 188 into 141 milligrams of bromine. The percentage of bromine in the compound is 80 divided by 188 multiplied by 141 divided by 250 into 100. That turns out to be 24. So, the compound contains 24% bromine. The next question can be considered of chemical kinetics, that is of activation energy, or it may be considered of p-block elements. It's an assertion reason type question. The assertion is, nitrogen and oxygen are the main components in the atmosphere, but these do not react to form oxides of nitrogen. The reason given for the question is, the reaction between nitrogen and oxygen requires high temperature. The first option is, both assertion and reason are correct. The second says, both assertion and reason are correct, and the reason is the correct explanation for the assertion. Third says, both assertion and reason are correct, but the reason is not the correct explanation of the assertion. Fourth explanation says, the assertion is incorrect, but the reason is correct. The two atoms of nitrogen in a nitrogen molecule are held together by a triple bond, while the two oxygen atoms in an oxygen molecule are held together by a double bond. When nitrogen and oxygen react to form nitric oxide, the energy released in the formation of two nitrogen-oxygen double bonds is not able to compensate for the energy required to break the bonds. This makes the reaction of oxygen and nitrogen endothermic. Further, a huge energy is required to break the triple bond between nitrogen atoms. A huge activation energy is necessary to initiate the reaction, which can only be provided by a very high temperature or a lightning flash. The above reaction requires the temperature of nearly 3000 degrees Celsius and is endothermic. So both assertion and reason are correct, and the reason is the correct explanation for the assertion. The next question is of thermodynamics. It gives the relation of Gibbs energy with equilibrium constant. The question says, the following reaction is performed at 298 Kelvin, that is 2NO gaseous plus O2 gaseous in equilibrium with 2NO2 gaseous. The standard free energy of formation of NO gaseous is 86.6 kilojoules per mole at 298 Kelvin. What is the standard free energy of formation of NO2 gaseous at 298 Kelvin? Kp is equal to 1.6 into 10 raised to power 12. Option, the first one, 0.5 multiplied by 2 multiplied by 86,600 minus R bracket 298 natural log 1.6 into 10 raised to power 12. The second one, R into 298 natural log 1.6 into 10 raised to power 12 minus 86,600. Third option, 86,600 plus R into 298 natural log 1.6 into 10 raised to power 12. And the fourth option, 86,600 plus natural log 1.6 into 10 raised to power 12 divided by R into 298. This question asks the relation of equilibrium constant with the change in free energy. The standard free energy is related to the equilibrium constant at constant pressure by the relation delta G naught, that is the standard Gibbs energy change, is equal to minus RT natural log of Kp. The Kp given in the question is 1.6 into 10 raised to power 12 and the temperature is 298 Kelvin. So delta G naught is equal to minus R into 298 natural log of 1.6 into 10 raised to power 12. For the given reaction, that is 2NO gaseous plus O2 gaseous in equilibrium with 2NO2 gaseous, the delta G naught, the standard Gibbs energy change in the reaction, is the summation of the Gibbs energy of formation of products minus the summation of Gibbs energy of formation of reactants. In this reaction, NO and O2 are reactants, but O2 is an element in standard state for which the standard Gibbs energy of formation is zero. The product in this reaction is NO2. Delta G naught reaction is equal to twice of delta G naught NO2, that is the Gibbs energy of formation of NO2, minus twice the delta G naught NO, that is the Gibbs energy of formation of NO. The standard free energy of formation of NO2 will be delta G naught NO2 is equal to delta G naught reaction plus twice of delta G naught NO whole divided by 2. Delta G naught NO is given as 86.6 kilojoules per mole, that is 86600 joules per mole. If we substitute these values in the expression, we get delta G naught of NO2 is equal to minus R into 298 natural log 1.6 into 10 raised to power 12 plus 2 into 86,600 whole divided by 2. And that's equal to 0.5 multiplied by 2 into 86,600 minus R into 298 natural log of 1.6 into 10 raised to power 12. The next question is from S block elements, that is solubility of salts. Question asks, which one of the following alkaline earth metal sulfate has its hydration enthalpy greater than its lattice enthalpy? And the option given are SrSO4 strontium sulfate, CaSO4 calcium sulfate, BeSO4 beryllium sulfate, and BaSO4 barium sulfate. The lattice and the hydration enthalpy both seem to be dependent on the same factor, that is the charge density of the ions. Higher is the charge density of the ions, higher is the lattice as well as the hydration energy. Still, there is a difference in their dependence. While the lattice energy depends on the inverse of the sum of the radius of the ions, the hydration energy depends on the sum of the inverse of the radius of the individual ions. The lattice energy dominates over hydration energy when the ions are of similar sizes, while the hydration energy dominates when there is a large disparity in the ionic sizes. In case of beryllium sulfate, the cation is very small while the anion is very large. So the hydration energy dominates over lattice energy. This makes beryllium sulfate very soluble in water. On moving down the group, the size of the anion and cation becomes similar as the size of the cation increases down the group and we find the solubility decreases. Strontium and barium sulfate are insoluble. The next question is from coordination compounds and organometallics and is from the topic isomerism, and that is geometrical isomerism. The question asks, the number of geometrical isomers that can exist for square planar complex PT, Cl, Py, NH3, NH2OH, where Py is pyridine, is, and the options are 6, 2, 3, and 4. The geometrical isomers are compounds which differ only in angle between any two reference groups. Square planar structure has two different angles, 90 degree and 180 degree. A square planar complex having four different ligands has three possibilities. It can be worked out by fixing the position of any one ligand and placing the other three one by one at the position 180 degree to it. Hence, there are in total three geometrical isomers to the given square planar complex. The next question is from haloalkanes and haloarenes. It asks, the synthesis of alkyl fluoride is best accomplished by, options are, Swartz reaction, free radical fluorination, Sandmeier's reaction, or Finkelstein's reaction. The partial fluorination of non-polar organic polyhalides, mostly aliphatic, with antimony trifluoride in the presence of antimony pentachloride or chlorine is generally referred to as the Swartz reaction. And the mixture of antimony trifluoride and chlorine, SbF3 plus Cl2, is known as the Swartz reagent. The free radical fluorination would cause exhaustive fluorination forming a mixture of compounds and also cause cleavage of carbon-carbon bonds. The Finkelstein reaction, named after the German chemist Hans Finkelstein, is an SN2 reaction, that is, substitution nucleophilic bimolecular reaction, that involves the exchange of one halogen atom for another. Halide exchange is an equilibrium reaction, but the reaction can be driven to completion by exploiting the differential solubility of halide salts or by using a large excess of the halide salt. The classic Finkelstein reaction entails the conversion of an alkyl chloride or an alkyl bromide to an alkyl iodide by treatment with a solution of sodium iodide in acetone. Sodium iodide is soluble in acetone and sodium chloride and sodium bromide are not. The reaction is driven towards product by mass action due to the precipitation of the insoluble salt. For example, bromoethane can be converted to iodoethane by treatment with sodium iodide in acetone. The Sandmeier reaction is a chemical reaction used to synthesize aryl halides from aryl diazonium salts. It is named after the Swiss chemist Trogot Sandmeier. The reaction is a method of substitution of an aromatic amino group via preparation of its diazonium salt followed by its displacement with a nucleophile, often catalyzed by copper 1 salts. The nucleophile can include halide ions, cyanide, thiols, water, and others. The reaction does not proceed well with a fluoride anion, but fluorination can be carried out using tetrafluoroborate anions, that is termed as Balz-Scheemann reaction. The next question is from bonding, and that to intermolecular interactions. The question says, the intermolecular interaction that is dependent on the inverse cube of distance between the molecules is hydrogen bond, ion-ion interaction, ion-dipole interaction, or London force. Intermolecular forces are the forces of attraction or repulsion which act between neighboring particles, which could be atoms, molecules, or ions. They are weak compared to the intramolecular forces, that is the forces which keep a molecule together. For example, the covalent bond involving the sharing of electron pairs between atoms is much stronger than the forces present between the neighboring molecules. They are an essential part of force fields frequently used in molecular mechanics. A hydrogen bond is the attraction between the lone pair of an electronegative atom and a hydrogen atom that is bonded to either nitrogen, oxygen, or fluorine. The hydrogen bond is often described as a strong electrostatic dipole-dipole interaction. However, it also has some features of covalent bonding. It is directional, stronger than a van der Waals interaction, produces interatomic distances shorter than the sum of van der Waals radii, and usually involves a limited number of interaction partners, which can be interpreted as a kind of valence. Intermolecular hydrogen bonding is responsible for the high boiling point of water, that is 100 degrees Celsius, compared to the other group 16 hydrides, which have no hydrogen bonds. Intramolecular hydrogen oxygen bonding is partly responsible for the secondary, tertiary, and quaternary structures of proteins and nucleic acid. It also plays an important role in the structure of polymers, both synthetic and natural. Hydrogen bond is similar to the covalent bond as it is directional and drastically decreases with a change in distance or even the angle. It is a short-range force which becomes zero beyond a certain distance, and over that distance, it is essentially only dipole-dipole interaction. Ion-ion interaction is a simple Coulombic interaction between two charges, which depends on the inverse of the square of the distance of separation. Ion dipole and ion induced dipole forces are similar to dipole dipole and induced dipole interactions, but involve ions instead of only polar and non-polar molecules. Ion dipole and ion induced dipole forces are stronger than dipole-dipole interaction because the charge of any ion is much greater than the charge of a dipole moment. Ion-dipole bonding is stronger than hydrogen bonding. An ion-dipole force consists of an ion and a polar molecule interacting. They align so that the positive and the negative groups are next to one another, allowing for maximum attraction. An ion-induced dipole force consists of an ion and a non-polar molecule interacting. Like a dipole-induced dipole force, the charge of the ion causes distortion of the electron cloud on the non-polar molecule. The ion-dipole interaction can be simply derived using the expression for a dipole, and it turns out to be dependent inversely on cube of the distance of separation. The van der Waals force arises from the interaction between uncharged atoms or molecules, leading not only to such phenomenon as the cohesion of the condensed phases and physical adsorption of gases, but also to a universal force of attraction between macroscopic bodies. The dominant contribution is the dispersion or London force, that is, fluctuating dipole-induced dipole, which arises due to the non-zero instantaneous dipole moments of all atoms and molecules. Such polarization can be induced either by a polar molecule or by the repulsion of negatively charged electron clouds in non-polar molecules. Thus, London interactions are caused by random fluctuations of electron density in an electron cloud. An atom with a large number of electrons will have a greater associated London force than an atom with fewer electrons. The dispersion, that is the London force, is the most important component because all materials are polarizable, whereas schism and Debye forces require permanent dipoles. The London interaction is universal and is present in an atom-atom interaction as well. For various reasons, London interaction, that is dispersion, have been considered relevant for interaction between macroscopic bodies in condensed system. Hamecker developed the theory of van der Waals between macroscopic bodies in 1937 and showed that the additivity of these interactions renders them considerably more long range. The energy of this type of interaction can be expressed by the equation V is equal to 3I alpha square divided by 4R raised to power 6, where R is the distance of separation, alpha is the polarizability, and I is the ionization potential. So the answer to this question is ion-dipole interaction, which depends on the inverse of the third power, that is the cube of the distance. The next question is from metallurgy, that is general principles and process of isolation of elements. The subtopic aluminium extraction. Question says, in the context of Hall-Heroult's process for the extraction of aluminium, which of the following statement is false? The first one, Na3AlF6 serves as the electrolyte. The second, carbon monoxide and carbon dioxide are produced in this process. Third, Al2O3 is mixed with calcium fluoride, CaF2, which lowers the melting point of the mixture and brings conductivity. And the fourth, aluminium ion is reduced at the cathode to form aluminium. In the metallurgy of aluminium, purified aluminium oxide is mixed with Na3AlF6 or CaF2, which lowers the melting point of the mix and brings conductivity. The fused matrix is electrolyzed. Steel cathode and graphite anode are used. The overall reaction may be taken as twice of aluminium oxide reacting with thrice of carbon to give 4 of aluminium plus 3 of carbon dioxide. The oxygen liberated at anode reacts with the carbon of anode producing carbon monoxide and carbon dioxide. The electrolytic reactions are cathode, aluminium ions in molten state consume 3 electrons to give aluminium liquid, while at anode, the carbon solid reacts with oxygen oxide ion of the melt to give carbon monoxide or carbon dioxide. Carbon monoxide is given out with release of 2 electrons, while carbon dioxide is given out with release of 4 electrons. So the false statement is that it is cryolite which behaves as electrolyte. In actuality, it is the mixture of cryolite, that is Na3AlF6, along with aluminium oxide, that is the electrolyte. The next question is from hydrocarbons of the topic geometrical isomerism. Question says, which of the following compounds will exhibit geometrical isomerism? The first one, 1,1-diphenyl-1-propene. Second one, 1-phenyl-2-butene. Third one, 3-phenyl-1-butene. And fourth one, 2-phenyl-1-butene. For any organic compound to show geometrical isomerism, it must satisfy 2 conditions. First one, it must have non-free rotation between 2 atoms. This non-free rotation could be due to the presence of a double bond, or it could be due to a cyclic structure. The second condition is, the 2 groups attached to any of the atom of the non-free rotation other than the non-free bond must not be identical. Let's consider each of the given compounds and their structures. The first compound has non-free rotation, but there are 2 identical groups, that is phenyl, attached to 1 carbon of the non-free rotation. Hence, it will not show geometrical isomerism. The second compound has non-free rotation, and both carbons of the non-free rotation have different groups attached to them. Hence, it will show geometrical isomerism. The third compound again has a non-free rotation, but one of the carbon of the non-free rotation has 2 hydrogen, that is the same groups attached to it. So, it will not show geometrical isomerism. The fourth compound again has non-free rotation, but one of the carbon of the non-free rotation again has 2 hydrogens, that is the same groups attached to it. So it again will not show geometrical isomerism. So only this particular compound, which has both carbons of the non-free rotation having different groups attached to it, will show geometrical isomerism. The next question is from classification of elements and periodicity in properties. It is from the subtopic ionic sizes. The question simply asks, the ionic radius in angstrom of N3- O2- and F- are respectively. First option says 1.71, 1.36 and 1.40. Second says 1.36, 1.40 and 1.71. Third says 1.71, 1.40 and 1.36, while the fourth says 1.36, 1.71 and 1.40. For isoelectronic species, that is the species which have the same electronic configuration, the one which has the highest positive charge has the smallest size, while the one having the highest negative charge is the largest. It is due to the effective nuclear charge, which depends on the number of protons in the nucleus and the electrons around the nucleus. As the protons increase, the effective nuclear charge increases, decreasing the size. Hence, N3 minus would be greater than O2 minus would be greater than F minus. The important fact about this question is you don't need to know the actual size of any of these ions. You just need to know the trend, as only one option has the value in this order, that is 1.71, 1.40 and 1.36. The next question is from hydrogen. Subtopic: hydrogen peroxide. It asks you, from the following statements regarding H2O2, choose the incorrect statement. The first one, it has to be kept away from dust. Second, it can act only as an oxidizing agent. Third, it decomposes on exposure to light. Fourth, it has to be stored in plastic or wax lined glass bottles in dark. Dust provides a charged surface to catalyze the decomposition of hydrogen peroxide. The oxygen in hydrogen peroxide has the oxidation state of -1, which allows it to show oxidation, that is, oxygen moving from -1 to 0 oxidation state, as well as reduction, in which oxygen moves from -1 to -2 oxidation state. Even light is able to initiate disproportionation of hydrogen peroxide, releasing water and oxygen. It must be stored in wax-lined plastic bottles, as the sodium ions leached from the glass bottles also catalyze its decomposition. So, the statement which claims that it can act only as an oxidizing agent is the false statement, because hydrogen peroxide has a capacity to act as oxidizing as well as reducing agent. The next question is from chemical kinetics. Subtopic: molecularity. It says, higher order, that is greater than 3, reactions are rare due to: first one, the loss of active species on collision. Second, low probability of simultaneous collision of all the reacting species. Third, increase in entropy and activation energy as more molecules are involved. Fourth, shifting of equilibrium towards reactant due to elastic collisions. The probability of 3-particle collision is extremely low. Most often, it would be 2-particle colliding followed by the 3rd particle, making it the reaction 2-step and each step bimolecular. Beyond 3, the probability is almost non-existent. The next question is from D and F block elements. It is the match the following type of questions, wherein in one column we are given the various catalysts and in the other column we are given the various processes. The match the catalyst to the correct process. The catalysts are TiCl3, PbCl2, CuCl2 and V2O5. While the process are Wacker process, Ziegler-Natta polymerization, contact process and Deacon's process. The Wacker process, or the Hoechst-Wacker process, named after the chemical companies of the same name, originally referred to the oxidation of ethylene to acetaldehyde by oxygen in water in presence of tetrachloropalladate 2 as the catalyst. The same basic reaction is used to produce aldehydes and ketones from a number of alkenes with Monsanto process for producing acetic acid. A Ziegler-Natta catalyst, named after Carl Ziegler and Giulio Natta, is a catalyst used in synthesis of polymers of 1 alkenes, that is alpha olefins. Catalysts based on titanium compounds are used in polymerization reaction in combination with co-catalysts, organoaluminium compounds such as triethyl aluminium, AlC2H5 thrice. The contact process is the current method for producing sulfuric acid in the high concentrations needed for industrial processes. Platinum used to be the catalyst for this reaction. However, as it is susceptible to reacting with arsenic impurities in the sulfur feedstock, vanadium 5 oxide V2O5 is now preferred. The Deacon process is a process used during the manufacture of alkalis. The initial end product was sodium carbonate by Lee Blanc process. Hydrogen chloride gas was converted to chlorine gas, which was then used to manufacture a commercially valuable bleaching powder. And at the same time, the emission of waste hydrochloric acid was curtailed. The reaction takes place at about 400 to 450 degrees Celsius in the presence of a variety of catalysts, including copper chloride. TiCl3 corresponds to Ziegler-Natta polymerization. PdCl2 corresponds to Wacker process. CuCl2 corresponds to Deacon's process. And V2O5 corresponds to contact process. The next question is from the P block elements, that is group 18. Which one has the highest boiling point? Xenon, helium, neon, or krypton? Noble gases are monoatomic molecules held together by only weak molecular interactions, that is the dispersion forces or London forces. These forces depend on the surface area of the molecule. Larger is the surface area, easier it is to polarize the electrons, and stronger are the forces. Stronger forces hold the particles and the boiling point increases. Amongst the choices given, Xe, xenon, is the heaviest and the largest noble gas. So, it obviously has the highest boiling point. The next question is from organic chemistry, from amines, that is nitrogen containing compounds. In the given reaction, that is the reaction of para toluidine, in presence of NaNO2 HCl at 0 to 5 degrees Celsius, it gives a product D, which on reacting with cuprous cyanide in presence of KCN and heat gives a product E along with release of nitrogen. So what would be the product E? The reaction of primary aromatic amine with sodium nitrite in acidic medium forms diazonium salt. This can undergo Sandmeyer's reaction with copper cyanide as catalyst and potassium cyanide to give a cyano product. The next question is from inorganic salt analysis. The question simply asks, which of the following compound is not colored yellow? Options are barium chromate, zinc ferrocyanide, potassium cobaltinitrite, and ammonium arsenomolybdate. In the analysis of fifth group of the salt analysis, the white precipitate obtained on addition of ammonium carbonate in presence of ammonium hydroxide and ammonium chloride is dissolved in acetic acid. If the salt contains barium, barium acetate is obtained. Addition of potassium chromate to barium acetate gives a yellow precipitate of barium chromate. In the confirmatory test of cobalt in the analysis of fourth group, the precipitate obtained after passing hydrogen sulfide is dissolved in aqua regia, that is, three parts of concentrated hydrochloric acid with one part of concentrated nitric acid. It gives cobalt 2 chloride. The solution is heated to dryness and cooled. It is dissolved in water and neutralized with ammonium hydroxide. It is then treated with a strong solution of potassium nitrite. When the solution is acidified with dilute acetic acid, a yellow precipitate of the complex of cobalt named potassium hexanitrito cobaltate 3 is formed. This can be used as a test for cobalt, nitrite, or even potassium. When potassium ferrocyanide solution is added to zinc solution after neutralization by ammonium hydroxide, a white or bluish white precipitate of zinc ferrocyanide appears. If group 2 precipitate dissolves in yellow ammonium sulfide and the color of the solution is yellow, this indicates the presence of arsenic 3 plus ions. Ammonium thioarsenide, formed on dissolution of arsenic sulfide, decomposes with dilute HCl and a yellow precipitate of arsenic 5 sulfide is formed, which dissolves in concentrated nitric acid on heating due to the formation of arsenic acid. On adding ammonium molybdate solution to the reaction mixture and heating, a canary yellow precipitate is formed. This confirms the presence of arsenic 3 plus ions. This test is identical to the test of phosphorus. Phosphorus and arsenic have very identical size, and so the chemical properties also match. So amongst the given choices, zinc ferrocyanide is the only one which is not yellow. Hence, this is the answer. The next question is from solid state, cubic arrangements. Sodium metal crystallizes in a body-centered cubic lattice with a unit edge length of 4.29 angstrom. The radius of the sodium atom is approximately, the options, 0.93 angstrom, 1.86 angstrom, 3.22 angstrom, and 5.72 angstrom. In a body-centered cube, there are in total 9 particles. Of these, 8 are present on the corners, while 1 is present in the center of the cube. The size of each particle is the same. Hence, the presence of one particle in the center forces the other 8 particles to move away. So, the particles at the corner do not touch each other. The particles touching each other are the 3 atoms on the body diagonal. The length of the body diagonal is 4 times the radius of the particle. For any cube, the body diagonal is square root of 3 of the edge length A. Hence, root 3A is equal to 4R. The given value of A is 4.29 angstrom. Substituting, we get root 3 multiplied by 4.29 is 4R. So R will be root 3 into 4.29 divided by 4, that is equal to 1.73 into 4.29 divided by 4, that is equal to 1.86. So the radius of the sodium atom would be 1.86 angstrom. You might be confused that how would you solve such a tedious calculation. This was the ideal method to solve this question, but actually, this method was not required. A small logic was enough to solve this question. For any kind of cubic arrangement, the edge length cannot be less than twice the radius and cannot be more than 4 times the radius of the particles making the cube. 0.93 is too less, while 3.22 and 5.72 are too large. So the answer could only be 1.86. Next question is from thermodynamics, and it again involves Gibbs energy and equilibrium. The standard Gibbs energy change at 300 Kelvin for the reaction 2A in equilibrium with B plus C is 2494.2 joules. At a given time, the composition of the reaction mixture is A is equal to half, B is equal to 2, and C is equal to half. The reaction proceeds in R value and E value are given. Options are reverse direction because Q is less than Kc, forward direction because Q is greater than Kc, reverse direction because Q is greater than Kc, or forward direction because Q is less than Kc. The direction of a reaction can be predicted by comparing the values of K and Q. If the magnitude of K is greater than Q, the reaction moves in the forward direction to attain equilibrium, while a lower value of K than Q indicates the backward movement of the reaction. Delta G naught is equal to minus RT ln K. Ln K is equal to delta G naught divided by R minus RT. Ln K would be equal to 2494.2 divided by minus 8.314 into 300. Ln K is equal to minus 1. That means K is equal to 1 by E, that is equal to 1 by 2.718. For the given concentration of the reactor and products, the reaction coefficient Q turns out to be 4. The magnitude of Q is greater than K, hence the reaction would proceed in the backward direction. Hence, the answer is reverse direction because Q is greater than Kc. The next question is from hydrocarbons, alkene, subtopic ozonolysis. Which compound would give 5-keto-2-methylhexanal upon ozonolysis? First one, second, third, or fourth? Ozonolysis cleaves the double bond and in its place creates carbonyl compounds. Both the carbon involved in the double bond convert to aldehyde or ketone. The product of ozonolysis of each of these compounds are, the first one gives 5-keto-4-methylhexanal. The second one gives heptane-2,6-dione. The third one gives 5-keto-2-methylhexanal. And the fourth one gives 5-keto-3-methylhexanal. Hence the answer is the third one, which gives us 5-keto-2-methylhexanal. The next question is from the chemistry in everyday life, that is chemistry in service of mankind, and the subtopic antacids. Which of the following compound is not an antacid? Ranitidine, aluminium hydroxide, cimetidine, or phenylazine? Ranitidine is in a group of drugs called histamine 2 blockers. Ranitidine works by reducing the amount of acid your stomach produces. Ranitidine is used to treat and prevent ulcers in the stomach and intestines. It also treats conditions in which the stomach produces too much acid, such as Zollinger-Ellison syndrome. Ranitidine also treats gastroesophageal reflux disease and other conditions in which acid backs up from the stomach into esophagus, causing heartburn. Aluminium hydroxide is used to treat the symptoms of too much stomach acid, such as stomach upset, heartburn, and acid indigestion. Aluminium hydroxide is an antacid that works quickly to lower the acid in the stomach. Liquid antacids usually work faster better than tablets or capsules. This medication works only on existing acid in the stomach. It does not prevent acid production. It may be used alone or with other medications that lower acid production. For example, H2 blockers such as cimetidine, ranitidine, and proton pump inhibitors such as omeprazole. Cimetidine INN is a histamine H2 receptor antagonist that inhibits stomach acid production. It is largely used in the treatment of heartburn and peptic ulcers. Phenelzine, that is also known as Nardil or Nardilzine, is a non-selective and irreversible monoamine oxidase inhibitor, MAOI, of the hydrazine class, which is used as an antidepressant and anxiolytic. Along with tranylcypromine and isocarboxacid, phenelzine is one of the few non-selective MAOIs still in widespread clinical use. So, amongst the given choices, phenelzine is not used as antacid. It is antidepressant. The next question is from organic chemistry, and it's from multiple topics: hydrocarbon, carboxylic acid, acid chloride, and aldehyde. In the following sequence of reaction, toluene reacting with KMnO4, the product reacting with thionyl chloride, the product further reacting with H2PD in presence of BaSO4, the final product. The product C is, could be benzaldehyde, benzoic acid, toluene, or benzyl alcohol. Oxidation of any group attached to benzene, and if that group contains one benzylic hydrogen, that is the hydrogen attached to carbon attached to benzene, with KMnO4 converts it to carboxylic acid. Reaction of carboxylic acid with thionyl chloride will give acid chloride, which on Rosenmund's reduction, that is reduction with poisoned palladium catalyst known as Lindler's catalyst, gives aldehyde, which in this case is benzaldehyde. The next question is from biomolecules, subtopic vitamins. Which of the vitamins given below is water soluble? Vitamin K, vitamin C, vitamin D, or vitamin E? Water soluble vitamins are carried to the body's tissue but are not stored in the body. They are found in plant and animal foods or dietary supplements and must be taken in daily. Vitamin C and members of vitamin B complex are water soluble. Fat soluble includes vitamin A, D, E, and K, all of which perform a variety of important functions in our body. Vitamin A, D, and K cooperate synergistically, not only with each other, but also with essential minerals like magnesium, calcium, and zinc. The next question is from D&F block, and it involves the color. The color of KMnO4 is due to, first one, sigma to sigma star transition. Second, M to L charge transfer transition. Third, D to D transition. And fourth, L to M charge transfer transition. The color of a species could be due to one of the many reasons. In case of colloids, the size of the particle is comparable to the wavelength of the visible light. Due to the scattering of the visible lights, the colloids may be colored. The color of the colloid typically changes with the size of the particle, even if the material remains the same. For example, the sulfur colloid could be milky white, yellow, or even green, depending on the size of sulfur particles. The color of transition metal ion is mostly due to transfer of electrons from one d orbital to another d orbital of the same subshell. It is observed in the ions which have partially filled d orbitals, that is d1 to d9. The energy of the d orbitals is different due to the field of the surrounding species. This transition generally falls in the visible spectra, hence is responsible for the color of most of the transition metal compounds. Another reason of color of the salts is the charge transfer spectra. It is the transfer of electron from one atom to another atom in the same structure. For it, the two orbitals on the different atoms should be similar in energy and the energy gap should fall in the visible spectra. This is typically observed in the ions such as permanganate, dichromate and chromate. In all these species, the metal ion is in a high oxidation state. The increase in oxidation state lowers the energy of the 3D orbitals, that is the M shell of the metal, and makes it similar to the 2p orbital, that is the L shell of oxygen. The electron moves from the L shell of the anion to the M shell of the cation with absorption of energy from the visible spectra and makes the species colored. Certain gases such as oxygen, chlorine are colored due to the transfer of electrons between molecular orbitals of the same molecule. Liquid oxygen is blue due to the transfer of an unpaired electron in the pi antibonding orbital to the other half-filled pi orbital with absorption of red light and aided by collision. Similarly, the halogen molecules are colored due to the transition of electron from pi star to sigma star. The sigma to sigma star transition typically requires a high energy and falls in the ultraviolet region. So, the color of potassium permanganate is due to the charge transfer from L to M. The next question is from electrochemistry, subtopic electrolysis. 2 Faraday of electricity is passed through a solution of copper sulfate. The mass of copper deposited at the cathode is, the atomic mass of copper is 63.5 AMU. The options are, first one, 127 grams, 0 grams, 63.5 grams, or 2 grams. To deposit one atom of copper, 2 electrons are required. To deposit 1 mole of copper, 2 mole electrons would be required. The charge of 1 mole of electron is 1 Faraday. So 2 Faraday would deposit 1 mole of copper, that is 63.5 grams of copper. That was the solution of 30 questions. I hope you would have got more information through the solution of these questions. Questions were easy, but they required good understanding and a conscious, slow and steady effort. All the best for your next exam.